our Lord and our Savior, who is risen from the dead. That is why we're here. All the other things that distract us, that separate us, we've left in our cars. And for this moment, we are one in Christ. We share in one another's joys. We share in one another's burdens. But we share in a shared life in Christ. And we are grateful for that. One quick announcement. Inside your bulletin, there should be an insert. Is there? Someone nod and say there is. Okay, good. That, I want to make sure you're welcome or you're invited or strongly encouraged to come on Wednesday nights. It's finally time. We are going to start with Rusty this conversation about moving forward and what we're going to do and how we're going to do it. And it's important, exceedingly important, that every voice be heard. And so the only thing that I would ask of you is that if you do not normally come on a Wednesday night, please make sure you notify Vicky or somebody that you are going to be coming if you want to eat. Because we normally prepare about 75 meals, but if we're going to have 125, we need to know. So please make sure that you're aware of that. We are here because Christ calls us together. We are here because we are family. We are here because we are in desperate need of knowing that we belong to someone, and that one in whom we belong is Jesus. Let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship in our call to worship. Out of the depths I cry to you, Lord, hear my voice. If you kept a record of sins, Lord, who could stand?
But with you, there is forgiveness, that we might serve you with reverence.
I wait for the Lord. My whole being waits. And in God's word, I put my hope.
We place hope in the Lord, and in God's.
Out of the depths, I cry to you, Lord, hear our voice. As is becoming normal for us, there are times when we have reports to be made, but we're understanding them. They are now Jesus' disciples returning and telling us all that they have heard and said and done. And so it is time now within the context and the life of our church to hear what is going on with the United Methodist Conference. And so Bill Barnett, our lay leader, is going to come and share a little bit about what's going on. Where is Bill? Bill? Oh, there you are, Bill. Sorry. I did it second service in a row. Come on up, Bill. And again, let's listen to not only what he is saying, but what the Holy Spirit has done as he comes and bears witness to it.
Annual conference. If you've heard me in the past report on previous annual conferences this year, then you know how much I enjoy attending annual conference. But this year I can say that I believe that for me personally, this was the most spiritually fulfilling conference that I've attended in the 4 years past as your lay delegate. Bishop Swanson's book, The Power of We, outlines four core values for Christian living: love, generosity, justice, and apprenticeship. Each year, the bishop adopts one of these core values as the focus or the theme for that conference. And this year, the emphasis was on apprenticeship. Now, I have to admit to you that at the start of this conference, I wasn't even sure what the term apprenticeship meant in the context of Christianity. But as things proceeded, as we worshiped together and we studied the Word together. Something clicked with me, and I got it. I really did. And I want to share with you just a bit of that in hopes that you get it too. An apprentice, as we all know, is a person who gains knowledge, wisdom, and skills from another person considered to be a master in his trade or profession. The verb form of apprentice, therefore, means to teach by example. Jesus apprenticed his disciples. He was the master of life, and he taught his disciples by example and by demonstration what it really meant to be all that God intended them to be. And when his time on earth was complete, he then commanded his disciples to pass on to others what they had learned. And so it was during this conference study of apprenticeship that I began to reflect on people who had taught me by example what it means to be a Christian. People who had literally and figuratively poured themselves into me. And that's when it clicked for me. That's when I got it. And I hope you get it too from what I'm saying. Because you see, at some point, it becomes our duty, yours and mine as Christians, to pour into someone else that which has been poured into us. Apprenticeship. It's a pretty good core value to live by as a Christian. Okay, as for the business of the conference, I believe the report most eager to be heard by those in attendance was the report given by Bishop Swanson about the work of a committee called the Commission on the Way Forward. Now, for those of you that may need some background on this commission and its purpose, the commission was created at the 2016 General Conference in Portland, Oregon. General conferences are just like annual conferences. They may be just a little bit bigger. But just as churches here in Mississippi have delegates like Margaret Herndon and myself that attend annual conference yearly, individual conferences around the world elect delegates to attend a general conference every 4 years where we as Methodists from all over the world gather to meet. It's where the business of the worldwide Methodist Church happens. It's where our book of discipline is molded, changed, and remolded. At the last general conference in 2016, the Council on Bishops created this commission on the way forward to develop recommendations for a special called conference this coming February 2019 in St. Louis, Missouri. That's just 6 months from now. That special conference has one purpose and one agenda, and that is to decide once and for all how the United Methodist Church views human sexuality theologically. Since the 1970s, the United Methodist Church has adopted a position that the practice of homosexuality is incompatible with biblical teachings. But it seems that ever since that language was added to our book of discipline, Methodists from around the world have been fussing and fighting about this issue at General Conference. At the last General Conference, this issue was especially contentious. And while no change in the current discipline was agreed to, the Council on Bishops created this Commission on the Way Forward, consisting of bishops, clergy, and lay people. The commission was tasked with the work of preparing a framework for how we as Methodists might move forward in the future around this issue. That was in 2016. Earlier this year, the commission announced that its work was complete and that it proposed three possible models or plans that might be considered at this upcoming called conference in February. One model is called the traditional plan, and that would basically maintain the current position in the discipline and would strengthen that position with additional powers of accountability by the Council of Bishops. Another model, called the One Church Plan, would essentially allow individual conferences and local churches freedom to decide on key issues. The third plan, called the Connectional Plan, is perhaps the most complex of the three and would basically do away with the current five jurisdictions in the United States and replace them with three connectional conferences, each with its own theological viewpoints on the issue of human sexuality. Now, it's important to understand that at this upcoming special called conference in St. Louis, the bishops will not be voting on this issue. The delegates elected from each annual conference will be the only ones voting on this issue. They can choose one of these to vote on one of these three plans presented by the Commission on the Way Forward, or they can throw them all out and they can vote on another plan. Our Mississippi Conference has 12 delegates elected to vote at this special called conference, 6 clergy, 6 lay representatives. If you wish to express your views on this issue, I encourage you to make them known to one or more of these delegates. I will be happy to provide you with a list of these delegates and their email address that are going from the Mississippi Conference. In fact, one of them lives right here in Brandon. If you just want to know more about this subject, the bishop has scheduled a series of listening sessions leading up to the special called conference. You can go to the Mississippi Conference website to see when and where these listening sessions will be held. They'll all be in this month, the month of August. And I think the closest one to us will be in Crystal Springs on August 27th. My message to you this morning on this subject is this. This is just one of many social issues of which our church seeks to find common ground and theological resolution. And regardless of how the meeting next February turns out, we need to keep our eyes clear on the bigger picture. I believe there are 4 things that are part of the bigger picture that far outweigh any opinions you or I may have on this issue. First, God is still in control. Second, Christ's message of love is still the main message, is it not? 3, the Holy Spirit still directs each of us personally in our daily lives. And 4th, The church is still called to serve here and everywhere. In preparation for what I wanted to report to you today, Trey shared with me some of the scriptures that were part of today's service. And one of those was from Psalms 130. It's part of our call to worship that we just read together. And there are two phrases in that call to worship that stood out to me as part of what I wanted to say today. Look in your call to worship, in your bulletin again with me, and find those phrases. If you'll look about midway through where it says, "I wait for the Lord," and then below it, it says, "And in God's word, I put my hope," meaning I put my faith. Wait on the Lord and put your trust in the Lord. So instead of reacting now to the recommendations of some commission on the way forward, I'm choosing to put my trust and faith in God, and I'm perfectly at peace knowing that if we simply wait on the Lord, that in His own time, it is He that will show us the way forward. Until then, let us here at Crossgates continue to move ahead with the excitement and the momentum that has been created with our new leadership here at this church. We need to get behind Trey and Rusty and support them with the ministries that we have ongoing and those that may be planned for the future. Trey's sermons every Sunday since he's arrived have been spot on. His enthusiasm is contagious. He's got the staff excited, and he's got me excited. Our giving since he's arrived has never looked better in this church, and our future has never looked better, in my opinion, for this church.
Amen. These are not empty words when we say that we share a life together. That when one of us hurts, we hurt. When one of us laughs, we laugh. When one of us is confused, we are confused. Rather short notice, George, if you want to go ahead and come on up. We had an opportunity to hear a song that George had written, came into Joey's office, I think, on Thursday, and Joey and I immediately said, this has got to be in the service. And I think that we think that an appropriate response to where we are as a church and where we are as a people called Methodist is to not only listen to the scriptures, listen to the Holy Spirit, to witness to what God is doing and you bring it back to us and share it, but to listen to what is pouring out in a man's heart. And so in this time of opening prayer, as he sings, listen and turn your heart to God.
The song comes out of last half of Romans 7, first half of Romans 8. Given to sin, I am inclined to, have always been, I've half a mind to. Given to sin, Lord, it's what you abhor each day. Hopelessly blind in my confusion, the sin I find offers no solution, but I can't kick it, Lord, am I that wicked Lord each day? I know it's right, but still I do the wrong. I love the light, but still the dark is strong. I look to you, my God. How long can this go on? Wretched man that I am, who can set me free? Who can? From the law that sin and death demands. Praise be to God through Jesus Christ, my Lord. My mind can praise him, but my flesh is not restored. I cannot take this deep conflict each day. Lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, the pride of life, they all need your forgiveness. Forgive them, Lord. That's what I'm hoping for each day. But now there is no more a condemnation for those who are living in Christ Jesus. The spirit of life here in Jesus Christ has freed us from the laws of sin and death. Well, if you've ever felt like me, you know you've got yourself a lot of company. Because the whole creation is subjected to futility, and it groans. And we ourselves in bodies unredeemed, we wait eagerly to be made clean. And in the time in between, we all groan. And oh, the Lord knows we groan. Well, taking the Lord as your Savior, it don't change all of your behaviors. But someday adoption will, and will end that end that we all hope. When I get redeemed and made white as the snow, you know there's only one place that I really want to go. And that's flat on my face before the throne of my God. And I just want to lay there and praise my God. And I just want to lay there and praise my God, because there is no more condemnation for those who are living in Christ Jesus. For the Spirit of life has freed us from the laws of sin and death. He's freed us from the laws of sin and death.
Many of us can identify being the wretched man and feeling as if we are too crying out of the darkness. Yet Christ shares with us that I did not come into this world to condemn the world, but to save it and to teach us of love, forgiveness. And in Christ, we find love. And in Christ, we find unity. And in Christ, we find hope, we find purpose, we find life. And in Christ, we find foundation. And so this morning, let us rise and sing together our hymn of unity, our foundational hymn that we share together. The church's one foundation is Jesus Christ, her Lord. Let us stand together as we sing the first, third, and fifth stanza of hymn number 546, 1, 3, and 5. Is learning from the master, teaching, being receptive to the teaching. And so you find recalling the psalmist say, "Teach me your ways, O Lord." In the epistle lesson this morning, Paul was writing to the church in Ephesus, and he shares with them teachings to take to heart. Teachings then that were relevant, teachings now for us that are relevant as well. Let us hear these words. "So then, putting away falsehood, let all of us speak the truth to our neighbors, for we are members of one another. Be angry, but do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and do not make room for the devil. Thieves must give up stealing. Rather, let them labor and work honestly with their own hands so that they have something to share with the needy. Let no evil talk come out of your mouths, but only what is useful for building up. As there is need, so that your words may give grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with which you were marked with a seal for the day of redemption. Put away from you all bitterness and wrath and anger and wrangling and slander, together with all malice, and be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ has forgiven you. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and live in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. Let us respond to the word by sharing together. We marvel at the wisdom of your word, O God of heaven. May these words we have heard become nourishment for our souls and guidance for the living of our daily lives. Write these words on our hearts, O Lord, that we may be reflections of your truth and mercy.
Amen. We're in this together. We are in Christ. We share a common life. We share a resurrected life. We share a redeemed life. But we also share in the sufferings of one another. And Paul says that when we suffer, we fill up the sufferings of Christ in some way. So when we laugh with everyone. And when we cry with everyone. But when we do it because we believe in the communion of saints. And so there are those things that we celebrate, and there are those things that cause us concern. I would like to draw everyone's attention to the chancel area. The flowers were given in memory of Frank Collins by his wife, Carol. For Mary Gibbs and her 98th birthday. For the 50th anniversary of Bob and Freddie Carr. We also have concerns for Cookie as she recovers. For Ben Barham, for Miriam May, for Steve Vickery, nephew of Clara Higginbotham, who has surgery on Tuesday. For the Rodemaker family on the death of Jerry's father. For Sandra Holmes, sister of Rosemary Robbins. For Kay Keaton and Elwood Martin. And for Tara, recovering from surgery, we are together. We are one body. So when we pray together. So let us now pray. O God, in whom we live and move and have our very being, O God, who hovered expectantly over the deep at creation, who continues to pour out and rush out across the world, creating, redeeming, reconciling. And for this church, we were created to be one with God and in Christ. Thank you, God, for your people. And yes, we need to continue to learn from you, to be forgiven by you. But you have given us this beautiful message of reconciliation. So may we in confidence always know that when we don't have the words to pray, we have some words that Jesus gave us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Come on, kids. Come on down and join me. Maybe. I like it. Thank you, Jack. You like it. Thank you, Madeline. Thank you, Garrett. Okay. So somebody tell me, what am I ready for?
Football.
Anybody else like football? Anybody else like to watch football? Like to play football? Anybody out here like football? Oh, yeah. There we go. Okay. Well, I need your help, though, because I love football. And you can tell, Colin, we got something matching here. Uh-oh. What is my helmet for?
Mississippi State.
Thank you, Miller. I love to watch college football, particularly SEC football, and it's about to be time. It's my favorite team for football. But I'm a little bit confused, and I need your help. Because actually, my most favorite team of all that I'm a part of and that I support is Team God. Are you part of God's team?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? And here's the deal. It's season. We're ready. Put me in, coach. That's what I said to God. But do you know what he said to me? He said, not yet. He said, wait. Now, my face looked a little bit like Madeline's face did when she came into Sunday school this morning. I like seeing your smile now. I think she might not have been completely awake yet when she got here. I don't understand why God told me to wait right now. Because I've got my jersey. I've got my
helmet.
My helmet. I've got the international symbol for touchdown? What is it? Nobody else knows how to make a touchdown? Thank you, Benton. Good job. I mean, I've been doing the stuff. I can say the words. But right now, God said, wait.
You're sure?
Not yet. But then he really confused me because he said something else. The coach, God, said, not yet, wait. But in a football game, if a player's not in at the moment, what do?
Cheer their team on.
Oh, that was good, Madeline. They cheer their team on. That's exactly right. Where would they probably be during the game if they're not playing right then?
On the bench.
On the bench. But here's the part that confused me. God said, just because I'm telling you to wait doesn't mean you go sit on the bench. What? Well, where do I go? What do I do? Help me for just a minute. Let's think about it. God told me to wait. He said, not yet. That means it's going to happen. What would be some things that I could do if I'm not supposed to sit on the bench? Because the other thing that he said was, I've got something really special. Be ready. What do I do to be ready? I got the jersey. I got the helmet. I call him coach. What could I do to be ready for when God says, okay, you're in? What could I do?
Be in.
I can't be in because coach hasn't put me in yet. What could I do?
Just go in.
Probably not a good idea to just go in. But you know, actually, Colin, you're right. Sometimes we do that. God says, right this minute, I need you to wait, but I need you to be ready. and we try to go in ourselves, it usually doesn't go so well. Let's use a lifeline. We're going to turn to the audience. What are some things I could do? Pray. Should I be praying?
Yep.
Yes. What else could I do?
Read your Bible. Yell loud.
Read my Bible. Sometimes I don't fully understand what that Bible says. What else could I do? Practice. Presley, that was beautiful because I think we're starting to get the point. I can come worship. I can read my Bible. I can ask for help in a Bible study. I can come to Sunday school. All of those things keep me off the bench and being ready for when he calls me. Because he didn't say he wasn't going to call me. He just said, what were his words? Not yet. And Presley, I love what you said because we all know our favorite football teams. Do the coaches put them in if they haven't practiced in between times?
No way,
Jose. God's calling you. He's got something for you. He may be saying not yet, but he also said don't sit on the bench. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for being the coach of all coaches. Thank you for the fact that you are ready and willing to direct every step of our lives. Help us to not sit on the bench, but to be ready for your call, not our way. In your name we pray, amen. You can join us in the back for kids' worship.
One of the ways that we practice our faith is to acknowledge that we are redeemed and reconciled people. And because we are redeemed and reconciled people, God accepts our gifts. So now is our time. Now is our time to give to God, to give to the work of the church, to say thank you, and to worship together.
Thank you.
standing.
Our gospel reading today is from the Gospel of John, chapter 6. Jesus replied, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." The Jewish opposition grumbled about him because he said, "I am the bread of life that came down from heaven." They asked, "Isn't this Jesus, Joseph's son, whose mother and father we know? How can he now say, 'I have come down from heaven'?" Jesus responded, "Don't grumble among yourselves. No one can come to me unless they are drawn to me by the Father who sent me. I will raise them up at the last day. It is written in the prophets, 'And they will all be taught by God. Everyone who has listened to the Father and learned from him comes to me. No one has seen the Father except the one who is from God. Now he has seen the Father. I assure you, whoever believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate manna in the wilderness and they died. This is the bread that comes down from heaven, so that whoever eats from it will never die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever, and the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh." This is the word of God for us, the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Confession is good for the soul, bad for the reputation. And I have a confession to make. I actually hurt my thigh muscle standing up. Oh my gosh. I need to practice more just doing the children's sermon. Whew. The confession that I have to make, though, is that we often use the word confession without even really knowing what it is. You see, confession just means to speak the truth to one another about something. Confession just means to say this is true to one another. I was thinking on the way over to church this morning that we oftentimes tell kids when they are fighting, when they've been wrestling with one another or fighting or said something they shouldn't. Now, Trey and Joey need to apologize. Well, you know what? I hate to tell you this. We don't need to apologize to one another. You know what the word apology means? To give a defense. Justify yourself. What were you thinking? What we mean to say with an apology is acknowledge you were wrong. So when kids struggle to apologize, they're rightfully so need to be confused. Wait, you want me to defend myself or not? Well, I have a confession to make. I speak truthfully, you speak truthfully back. I may be in the wrong, but you speak back to me and say, "Yes, that is right. It is right. It is right that we should be reconciled. It is right that we should." But confession has so many different components to it. In the passages of Scripture that we have been hearing today and studying together, there are three types of confession. The psalmist, you know what the psalmist is confessing? How they feel. They're just talking the truth to God. "God, this is how I feel. You know how I feel? Well, God, I feel like I'm in a pit. I feel like I'm in the depths. Where are you? I am hurting. Who do I cry out to? Lord, will you hear my voice? Please hear me. You know, God, if you kept track of my sins, I would be in a horrible place. God, I confess this to you. But forgiveness is with you. Forgiveness is. And that's why we honor you, God, because you are forgiving. Because you allow us to confess to you that we are wrong and you are right. That's an act of grace, oh God. I hope, Lord, My whole being hopes for you, and I wait on you. I confess this to you, God. This is how I feel. My whole being waits for you, like a night watchman watches for the dawn. Israel, wait for the Lord, because faithful love is with the Lord, because great redemption is with our God. He is the one that will redeem Israel from all its sin. We confess to God. God, this is how I feel. This is what I think. Sometimes what we confess to God in the context of truthful relationship with God, we even say things like David said when he was so upset about the enemy's winning. Do you know the psalm I'm talking about? Oh, that their babies' heads would be dashed against the rocks. God, I confess to you that's not who I want to be or where I want to be, that's how I feel. I'm so angry that not only do I want to punish the person that I'm upset with, I want to punish everyone that they love. Why would we say such a thing to God? Because my whole being waits for the Lord. Because in Him is forgiveness, and in Him is reconciliation. So we confess to God, this is how I feel. This is what I think. But confession doesn't stop there. You see, confession moves forward into what Paul was talking about with his friends in Ephesus. Confession also acknowledges what I say and what I do. Paul says, therefore, after you've gotten rid of lying, each of you must tell the truth to your neighbor, because we are parts of each other in the same body. It's the hard part of being a Christian right there. We have to tell the truth to one another because we share one body. If that second part wasn't there, confession wouldn't make any sense, and telling the truth wouldn't make any sense. We share the same space. We share the same Lord. We share the same cup and table. We share the same hymn book. We share the same choir. We share the same scriptures. So we must tell the truth to one another. We must. Now here's where, though, I think we get backwards. When we're confessing, or if someone has done something against us, you know what we often do? We make ourselves in the right, and we make them in the wrong. I'm going to mess with Joey. I have no problem with Joey. I just want y'all to know that. Here's the way it works, though. The truth is this. The cross stands between us. The cross gives us our identity. The cross is our truth. So when we confess our sins to one another, you know what we're doing? We're acknowledging that the cross is right, that God is right. We're not acknowledging that Joey is right or that Trey is right. We're acknowledging that Jesus is right. Oh, the conflict we get into when we want to be right instead of wanting everyone to be right with God and with one another. Confession. I confess to you, God, that you are right, that your way is right. And when I struggle, because I know that means that I need to say I'm sorry, it's because of this truth that God is what brings us together. God is who brings us together. That the love of Christ, that Christ's sacrifice, is what unites us. Not anything else. I confess that to you. I confess that to every single one of you. There will come a time when I will do something that maybe I shouldn't do, or maybe I should have done but didn't do, or something that I didn't know I did that hurt you, or that I forgot to make a phone call or send a letter. I confess to you now that that is going to be true. But here's what I want you to confess back to me. That you will come to me and tell me that. You will come and tell me the truth. And you will not say, I want to be right or I want you to be wrong. Come, let's go to this cross for the truth and let us be reconciled to one another. That is who we are. We confess to one another, not because we want to ruin each other's reputations, but because we want to be united in Christ. So what do we do now? We've confessed it. We truthfully acknowledge to one another. What do we do? Well, Paul says further down in Ephesians, don't let any foul words come out of your mouth. Only say what's helpful for building the community up so that it benefits everyone who hears. And then he says this great word. Don't make the Spirit of God unhappy. You were sealed by him for the day of redemption. For those of you who were here last week, I almost caught my robe on fire, and Rusty was throwing water all over the place like it was a Russian Orthodox baptism. But everybody came who was here, and they heard these words. You belong to Jesus. Remember your baptism. You were sealed, every single one of us, sealed. Every single one of us, sealed. Don't you forget that. Don't you forget that you are sealed for the day of redemption when God will come. And because we're sealed, Paul says, put aside the bitterness, the temper tantrums, the anger, the shouting, the slander, every other kind of evil. Instead, be kind, be compassionate, be forgiving to each other in the same way that God forgave you in Christ. Because here's the deal with confession. We can't just say that that is true without changing in the process. The word that we use in the church that you hear in the Bible is the word repentance. The Greek word is metanoia. It talks about changing the way you think. The Hebrew concept of repentance is change the direction you're going, change the way you're acting. Both are true. But here's the deal with confession. If all I do is agree with you that what has happened is wrong or not the best, then I'm still here. Repentance does this. I agree I lost my anger. I lost my temper and became angry. And I sinned in that. Okay? I've said it. Now what? Repentance is not turning just away from. It's turning towards Jesus. It's turning towards cross. And it's also turning towards one another. We don't just turn away from sin. You know, that's why we go back to it so fast, is that we turn away from sin, but not towards God and towards God's people. I confess to you now, I need you, because I can't do this alone. It's not enough to simply say, don't be angry. It's enough then to say, Joey, grab my hand and help me be filled with compassion. Help me remember that Jesus is who brings me together with you. Because other than that, I can't find a way to make it work. And Paul says, therefore, I want you to imitate God as if you were, not if, let me rephrase that. I want you to imitate God because you're God's child, deeply loved by God. Live your life with love, following the example of Christ, who gave himself up for us. And his sacrifice was beautiful and sweet to God because he was in full confession and unity with God. He confessed to God, I am your son, you are my father, I need you. So we are told to do what? Imitate God as dearly loved children. You remember when we used to walk around with those bracelets on, what would Jesus do? I think it's a great way to remember, but I had a big problem with that because of the second W. What would Jesus do? We already know what Jesus would do. We already know. That would puts it in there as if it's difficult to figure out. We know exactly what Jesus would do. Absolutely. And so what we are called to do then is imitate God. Imitate a God who says, I'm not giving up on you. Imitate a God that says, I'm pouring my Holy Spirit out across the world. I'm not giving up. I'm going to work in your life whether you like it or not. I'm going to work in your life and bring gifts up in your life until, Taylor, one day you're going to recognize that I love you. And you're going to come to me and we're going to celebrate. And salvation will come. And then I'm going to spend the rest of my life working with you to help you become who you are in me. And we're going to make you holy. We're going to set you apart. We're going to do something amazing. You're going to be my child. Just keep Jesus in the center and act like you're a child of God because you are. The final confession that we have here is Jesus' confession, a confession of who I am and what I believe. Jesus confessed the most provocative thing that a human being could ever confess in the Jewish community. You know what he said? He said, Yahweh. Ego eimi. I am. I am. I am the bread of life. I am. For those of you who hadn't made the connection yet, I am is how God described himself to Moses. What is your name? Moses said. And God said, I am. I will be who I will be. You let me define me. I am. And God in Christ, he confessed, I am the bread of life. Why would Jesus say that? You remember just a few weeks ago, the feeding of the 5,000 and how that great miracle occurred? You know what they did the next day? Remember how exhausted and tired they were? And Jesus and the disciples wanted to get away. You know what that crowd did? They wanted more bread. They wanted more fish. They ran to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, Sea of Capernaum, and wanted more bread. And Jesus said, why are you here? You want a little bit of bread. That's not who I am. Y'all tried to come and make me king by force. That's not who I am. I've got something for you instead. You want bread that'll never leave you hungry? I got it for you. I am the bread of life, he said. I confess that. I am the bread of life. Now, do you want that? Do you want that? Or do you want your belly filled? Because you can get your belly filled every day if you want it. I'm not the one who needs to do that for you. I tried to show you who God was, and instead you wanted it for selfish reasons. I am the bread of life. I confess to you. And then he says, Jesus says, to specifically the Jewish leaders, you don't get it. You don't get it. You need to be taught. It's written in the prophets that everyone who is taught by God will come. God teaches. God apprentices. God shows. And throughout this conversation about bread, Jesus says, I am that. I will feed you. I will teach you. I will lead you. I will guide you. And so we now come full circle with what we've heard about confession. But we also hear what Bill was teaching us this morning. The disciples returned and told Jesus everything that they had said and done. Bill went off for us to the annual conference. And in that, he saw apprenticeship, God working. And he saw the need to wait and trust in God. And he confessed before us what God is doing. And he confessed before us what he felt like we needed to do. And he confessed to us. He even asked us to repent. He just didn't say it. Did you know you did that? He asks us to turn away from something and turn towards something. Turn towards hope in God. Turns toward the scripture. Turn toward apprenticeship, waiting. The children's sermon, really, I mean, I could just stop there, but that every time she does what she does. But that's the whole point, too. Waiting on the Lord is an active thing. You just might pull your calf muscle waiting on the Lord. Wait on the Lord. Put me in, coach. Put me in. Not yet. Not yet. Get ready. We practice. I got a special play for you. Just be ready. It's also like our military forces. They train and 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 then they train some more and then they train some more and then when they're done training, they train some more and then they train some more. So that when that time comes that they are deployed, you know they know exactly what to do and there is no thinking anymore because they're so behaviorally conditioned to do it, they just do it. But they train and they train and they train and then they wait. And they wait. And many times we pray that they're not deployed and they never have to do it. But they train and they train and they train and they wait. And so it is in God's army, God's people. We train and we train and we train and we confess and we repent and we pray and we sing and we listen to scriptures and we take communion, we celebrate baptism, we conference with one another and we wait on the Lord. We wait because God feeds us fully in the life of His Son. So I confess to you, and I want you to confess back to me, that we can hide our lives in God because we need to live there. And we can go to God and we can say, take my life. Let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my life. Take my brain. Take my feet. Take my ears. Take my eyes. Take everything. Put it to work. Help me be holy. Help me surrender. I confess to You, O God, I need You. So that is our calling today, my invitation to all of us. Let us confess our faith in Jesus Christ. If there is any reason why you'd like to come and talk with me about where you are in your relationship with God, a decision that you'd like to make public, set up a time. Grab me afterwards. But let's do this together. Let us do it together and sing, Take My Life and Let It Be.
Let us stand together and sing in the first stanza of Take My Life and Let It Be Consecrated, Lord, to Thee.
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of Thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift.
We have one final confession to make. We are sent people. We don't just come here to hear this and be satisfied among ourselves. We are sent. We are sent with this good news that God is at work in your life even before you know it. Find someone this week to tell them just that. Tell them, I see something beautiful in you and I think it's God. And if they say, I don't know what you're talking about, then help them understand that that's God not giving up on them. And if they say to you, I am a Christian, then you say, I see God at work in you even more. Why don't you go tell somebody else? It's because here's the deal with our faith. We are a sent people because Jesus rides before us. Jesus goes out. Ride on, King Jesus. Jesus is King of Kings, and he's Lord of Lords. Sing us out of here.